Good morning, Gateway, to those in the room, to those joining us online. Welcome. My name is Ross. I'm one of the pastors here at our North Campus. It really is my honor to be among the first to say thank you so much for joining us this morning. And whether you find yourself today saying, you know what, I've been on this faith journey for a really long time, or maybe you're in the room or joining us online and you're saying, you know, I'm really just checking this faith thing out, maybe for the first time, maybe in a long time. Here at Gateway, we really do take seriously creating excellent environments like this one where we can explore who God is, what he's like, and ultimately discover, like so many of us have, that he's good, that he loves us, that he wants good for us. And part of the way we explore that is through this thing called worship. And so we're gonna sing some songs. We're gonna sing back to God who we believe he is. And so if you're in the room, would you stand with me? And if you're online, you can stand too. Let's worship God together this morning. Let's do it.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness.
They hold us safe within his promise. guys, thanks so much for singing with us. Go ahead and have a seat.
Well, good morning. Welcome to Gateway. We're so glad that you are with us. A lot of you are watching online. Maybe some of you got out on that early vacation. We hate you. I mean, we love you. So happy for you. Yeah, that was a bad joke. I'm really sorry. Now you're gonna feel bad for taking a vacation. I'm taking a vacation this summer, so don't feel bad about it. Then some of you are at campuses. Some of you are still home, and you're in maybe in a situation where you still need to be home, and we love you. We're so glad you joined us. And a lot of you are in the room. If you're in the room, let them hear you. Yeah, you're back in the room. Yeah. It's so good to see many of you. My name's Carlos. I'm the pastor here at our Gateway North campus, and I'm excited to be able to bring God's word today and challenge us as we start a new series called Trust Me If You Can. And I wrote the brief for it, and I was talking to John, our lead pastor, about it, and our team, just what God was impressing on us over probably 6 months ago when we started planning this. I was talking to some of our staff as we were really still in the middle of the pandemic, and people were home, and we had a few people still coming to service. Most people online, like many of you. And we started finding this theme that was coming up as we're having conversations with people. And I got to tell you, some of you aren't going to like the series, not because it's going to be bad content, not because it's going to be something that we're harping on you about, but just because it's a real issue that many of us are dealing with, if not all of us are dealing with. And we're going to deal with this word. It's a five-letter word that many of us really struggle with, and it's the word trust. And what we found as staff in the middle of the pandemic over the last 15 months, working with people, loving people, caring for people, meeting new people, is this erosion of trust. And just be honest, the erosion of trust didn't begin with the pandemic. It was something that's already cultural, an issue for us. And this word trust, it evokes pain for some of us. It evokes a lack of confidence. And this word trust, it's hard to come by trust. It's hard to give trust. We with this word, we want to gain your heart. We want to get your approval. Somebody wants your vote. Somebody wants your business. Somebody looks at you and says, just trust me. And I don't know if people understand what they're asking for when they look at you and me and they say, just trust me. Do they know our story? Do they know our pain? Do they know where we come from? Do they know that trust is not easy to come by? It's hard to earn it. It's hard to keep it. It's hard to give it. And yet we are challenged over and over in Scripture to trust. We're challenged in our relationships, in our work environment, and with our government, local, state, federal, to trust. And where are we when it comes to trust? And what does that really look like? So thank you for trusting us, whether you know it or not, from this weekend and the weekends to come, because we're going to take you on a journey. We're going to take you on a magic carpet ride, like Aladdin told Jasmine, do you trust me? I mean, really, we're going to take you on a journey because we're going to talk about trust in a general sense today. And then we're going to talk about, can you trust those in authority, people who lead you? Where's your trust when it comes to relationships? And where's your trust when it comes to God? And do you even trust God or trust the local church? Because we know it's a real issue. We know that this has been going on, and then the pandemic hit, and forget it. It's election year, and we have economic issues, and there's social unrest, and COVID or corona. What do we even, we can't even agree what to call it. And we felt it. You felt it. And yet, the research is showing that there's a difference when it comes to trust in the different generations. I mean, I'm Gen X. We don't trust anybody anyway, right? It's just who we are. We trust ourselves. That's what we were taught. Our generation, Gen X, was told, you are good for nothing. We were the smallest generation in the history of the United States. You didn't want us, boomers. So we're the smallest generation. And so we said, we're going to show you. So we're going to have a ton of kids. So that generation is bigger than yours, boomer. We have this tension within the generations. And the research is really showing that. And every generation has a different way they want our country and local community to function. And our younger generations are saying, they're just have that happening. They're like, you know what, mom, dad, grandpa, we're not having it. We want it this way. And then we as older people look at our kids like, you have no idea what you're doing. You're gonna ruin our country. And then we have this lack of trust and we have these arguments and these things begin to happen. But you gotta know before the pandemic, Pew Research had a lot of studies going on, and they found that 71% of young adults felt that people will take advantage of them if they get the chance. Pre-pandemic. Like, we raised a generation to believe and to not believe in relationships, to have mistrust. And maybe that's because we wanted them to be ready for the real world. At least that's my excuse I tell myself. I have three daughters. And my wife's like, you know, sometimes you're kind of hard on the girls. You know, sometimes they want to be your princess. I'm like, nobody's going to treat them like a princess in the real world. My wife's like, yeah, but they're here with you right now. Because we want to prepare them for the real world. And the notion of there being a socialized trust. And socialized trust is this idea that people are going to be out for your own good, for the good of the society. And they're going to make decisions that benefit one another. There's going to be a trust that, hey, I'm going to drive a particular way to keep other people safe. And isn't it crazy that the stats coming out that as people are leaving their homes, like they forgot to drive over the last year. Any of you felt that when you're driving on the road? You're like, hey, you just turn on the blinker and you turn right here. I've seen people going wrong ways on the road. I'm like, did you just forget how to drive? But it happens. The socialized idea that people are for the good of everybody else, that's eroded so many people's trust. I was reading some articles, and I read one by this journalist named David Brooks, and he says this about the coming generation. He says, we're living in the age of that disappointment. The millennials and members of Gen Z have grown up in the age of that disappointment, knowing nothing else. And in the U.S. and elsewhere, this has produced a crisis of faith. And across society, but especially among the young, it has produced a crisis of trust. So instead of just telling you about this crisis, instead of just showing you the stats, we decided, our creative team decided to hit the streets of Austin and start interviewing people and asking them about how they felt about trust issues. So just take a minute and watch this video with us.
I got a couple questions about trust for you. Who do you trust most in life?
My wife.
That was a good answer. She's gonna be happy with that.
It's funny, we were just talking about this. Probably my father. He's always been the problem solver and the solution bringer when things started to feel like they were falling apart.
Is there anybody you don't trust?
I never thought about that.
What would you say would make somebody trustworthy or not trustworthy?
Money. How they acquire it and why.
When I say the word trust, what do you think of?
This underlying faith that things aren't going to shake you up too bad.
And then what do you think of like politicians? Are they trustworthy?
For the most part, no.
So when I look at politicians, like, tell, you know, you're a human being, even if you're president of the United States or mayor of a city, or tell the things that you made a mistake on and how you learn from it, how you're not going to repeat it. But don't tell me all the great things you're doing, because it's not true. There's no way with this many decisions you could make 100% right. It's impossible.
Yeah, I really appreciate politicians that just keep going for what they believe is truth and don't shift along the way.
Do you trust the church?
Yes.
Why?
The church is the oldest form of uplifting people and reaching for that higher power to overcome challenges.
Do you think the church is a trustworthy institution?
I mean, mega churches, definitely not. Quaker groups, yes. Along those lines, those are two extremes.
I think for pastors, it's telling the truth in love. Not everybody wants to hear the truth, and sometimes it's hard to say the truth, but if you believe, you have to stick to the truth, but you have to do it in a way that brings peace to people and doesn't feel like condemnation.
Do you trust God?
Of course.
Yeah.
I'm a runner, and that's what I normally tap into when I feel like I need to stop. I just, you know, look up, because once you have that attention mindset to look up and ask for help, it comes to you in your time of need, so to speak.
Gosh, that's a hard one. I think you have to really sink into the idea that he doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. Some of the topics seem different today than in that day, but he doesn't change. And if you can get rooted in that, even though scenarios change and you might not always know exactly how to interpret the scenario in light of what he said, that you just have to know he doesn't change. And that does bring me a lot of comfort.
Now, that was a great video, and it was good, but can I tell you the tension? The creative team went out to do those interviews, and normally we can talk to dozens of people. Those are the only four people who wanted to talk to us. And we actually talked to more, and then they contacted us and said, you know what, we really don't want you playing that. We saw firsthand this lack of trust. I mean, normally people are just asking generic questions, and most people don't, and people want their 15 minutes of fame or whatever. People want to talk, and they overtalk, and yet the team, they wrote me a message to say, hey, here's the video. Nobody wanted to talk to us. And it was a real-life example of what we're talking about, this trust issue. And I'm just going to make a statement that you might not like. But I'm going to look at every one of you across this room, and I'm going to look in the camera and say, you got issues. I have issues. And if we don't think we have an issue with trust, or that it's not something that we have to be intentional about, we are fooling ourselves. So, take a deep breath. Everybody, come on, take it in. Let it out, but don't blow on the person in front of you. Like really nicely let it out. We've learned that. Don't just blow everywhere, you know. Jeremiah 17. We're going to go to scripture, and we're going to talk to ourselves. I'm going to ask you some questions. I want you thinking through some of the questions I ask. And how do we inform ourselves about the issue of trust? What does scripture tell us about the issue of trust? In Jeremiah 17, verse 5 starts out really strong. I'm just going to warn you, starts out really strong. Verse 5, cursed. There you go. Let's just start right there. You're cursed. Cursed is the one who trusts in man or humans, who draws strength from mere flesh and whose heart turns away from the Lord. So give me some context of what that word cursed means. It's not going off the Aladdin theme, Jafar, you know, putting a curse over you and your family. It's not some magical thing. Cursed in that sense is, cursed are you if you decide to live your life the way you think it ought to be and it doesn't line up with God's intentions for you. How he designed you, how he designed relationships, how God's intentions work for community. If you decide, I am going to take matters into my own hands, cursed are you. It's the same as I've done with my children and many of you have done with yours. Here's your budget. You want a prom dress? I get it. Here's your $25. Make it happen. Just kidding, not $25. Here's your $100 for the, but Dad, the dress I want is $325. Well, here's where I begin, here's where I end, the rest is on you, right? I'm gonna give you the $100. I'm gonna entrust you with money. I'm going to entrust you with a car. Maybe you buy your children a car. Here are the rules. And then your children decide to do whatever they want with the resource you gave them, and then somehow it's your fault it didn't work out. And you're like saying, cursed on you. Hopefully you're not cursing at them. Cursed on you. It's not that you don't want them, you want their demise. And it's not that you want your children ruined. This verse is saying, cursed are you. You went out of the boundary of the guidelines we set for this. And when you do that, the consequences are on you. And that's what Jeremiah is saying. Cursed are you when you put your trust in humans. Fully put your trust. And verse 6 says, that person will be like a bush in the wasteland They will not see prosperity when it comes. They will dwell in the parched places of the desert, in salt land where nobody lives. That's a pretty picture, right? Like if you put your trust in humans, what you're doing is, yeah, there might be a little bit of rain, and you might grow a little bit, but you're surrounded by salt, and it's going to kill whatever vegetation you're trying to grow. You're not really going to be able to thrive. You're not really going to be able to grow because the elements surrounding us as humans is going to destroy whatever you try to build. Verse 7, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. They will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. It does not fear when heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never fails to bear fruit. It's a very different picture. It's different imagery than we got when we put our trust in humans. We put all of our confidence, all of our money, all of our time, everything that we have into humans, we get what we get. But when we put our trust in God, there's a different imagery. There's an imagery of whatever comes, you're gonna be okay. Your tree's going to continue to grow. You're still going to bear fruit. Many times we put our trust in things that really are not beneficial to us. We have to be careful about that. So how does this passage inform us about trust? Remember, we're just kind of doing an overview this week before we dive into very specific issues over the next 3 weeks. And I'm going to ask you to really follow along. We're going to ask you some good questions, things to be thinking about, things to be talking about with your family. These are great things that you can talk about with your children, right? We do this with our own children. We sit down and we ask them honest questions, and they give us the answers that they want to give. We don't like the answers, but we asked honest questions. And my daddy used to always tell me, if you ask an honest question, you should get what? An honest answer. So we're going to ask you some honest questions. It's questions that we're asking ourselves, questions we're asking our own staff, questions we're asking our own families in light of what Scripture is saying. So what is this passage? What are a few things we can learn from this? Number one, trust is actually about us, not about others. Jeremiah is writing in such a way that we get to decide where our trust goes. We get to decide where we put our trust and our confidence. The circumstance and those around us and what they do with that should not impact our ability to trust. We trust. We do. We take the step. Now, we're not taught this in our culture. We're not taught to trust very easily, as the stats are showing us. We're taught that the other people, those other people, are our parents, our teachers, our legislation, that they are the cause of our dysfunction. But really, there might be some effects of that, but we get to choose what we do with trust. I mean, we're taught this: you trust, but you verify. You're taught trust is earned and not given. We're taught this: fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. There's a limit to my trust, but if we're not careful, all these sayings and things we talk about, they create a defensive posture towards one another. It causes us to keep score. And can you imagine if Jesus kept score? Can you imagine Jesus scorned going to a cross and he's saying, I'm gonna die for Joe in 2021, but this only lasts for the first 10 sins he commits. But this is how we live. We keep score. I don't like to keep score because I don't want to be defensive, because it feeds a part of me that is unhealthy. Because if I start to keep score, I don't just keep it here, I actually put it on a spreadsheet. When I first married into Libby's family, it was a very different dynamic than my family. My family has very clear boundaries because I made sure we created them as a kid, because my parents didn't have boundaries. You know, you grew up with, this is a lot of families, but you grew up in our family, especially with a Puerto Rican dad, there are no boundaries. I remember my grandmother would come visit and she would sleep with my mom and dad in the bed. I'm like, that is weird. I remember being 10 years old saying, Dad, you're never gonna come sleep with me when I'm married. It was just this weird dynamic, but it's just part of the culture. It's just, they love one another and there's a lot of touching and hugging and kissing and blah, blah, blah. I was like, hey, hold on. I have a boundary. Now, those of you who know me are like, no, you don't. Okay, I did have a boundary. Then I married Libby, and Libby's family has no, they just talk about everything. They talk about money and politics, and they just live life together, and everything's like this, and they call each other, and they text each other, and they're on these group texts, and I'm like, I didn't want to know that about your sister. I didn't want to know that about your brothers. Oh, this is the way we live life. And then when it came to money, and I'm kind of a stickler when it comes to money, like, you know, good stewardship and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, where'd you get that shirt? Oh, my sister bought it for me. I'll buy something for her later on. I'm like, well, hold up. Well, how much was it so I can keep track of what she spent on you? She's like, no, it's just, that's not how we do things. You know, if I spend more than her, that's fine. She'll buy something for me, and I'll buy her coffee, and then she'll buy her dinner. And I could not tabulate it in my mind, keeping score. I'm like, so who owes who? How do you keep track of this? Some of you are laughing because your families are like that. But it drove me nuts because I don't like to owe anybody anything. I overpay in my taxes knowing, because I don't want to deal with the IRS. Well, that's your money. You should invest it. You know what? It saves me the anxiety of seeing the IRS letter coming to my mailbox. I don't want to owe anybody, but I've learned that it's because I had trust issues. And I was coming from a defensive posture. And actually, this quote, something that this challenged me. I remember when I was in college and I read this. The best way to find out if you can trust somebody is to trust them, Ernest Hemingway. Just do it. I'm like, whoa, hold on. Like, what do you mean just trust him? Like, just trust him. I'm like, oh, how do you do that? And I had to learn. You have to learn. We have to relearn what this looks like. And in light of scripture, we learn that we should not trust all humanity with everything that we are. We have to be intentional. But guess what? You get to choose. Jeremiah says, you get to choose where your confidence lies, where you put your trust. Matthew 14, there's a passage of Peter and Jesus. And most times when you read this passage, it's about Peter walking on the water. So it's a passage about faith. It's a passage of Jesus tells Peter, walk on the water. And if you don't know the story, real quick, the disciples of Jesus, there were 12 disciples. There were more than that, but 12 that Jesus identified as disciples and followers. They're in a boat on the water. And Jesus is not with them. And he's going to catch up with them. And in good Jesus fashion, he just decides to walk on the water in the middle of a storm. And the disciples are freaking out because they're in the middle of a storm on the water and they see what they think is a ghost. And they're freaking out. If it's not bad enough, we might be shipwrecked, but now there's a ghost coming at us? Are you kidding me? They couldn't identify that it was Jesus. They knew he had the power to do, but they didn't identify him as Jesus. And then Jesus gets close enough and he says, come to Peter. And if I were Peter, I'd be like, okay, can you at least stop the storm? Let's at least get some calm water where I can see where I'm gonna step. But no, the storm is raging and he calls Peter out. And most times when this passage is taught in the angle of faith. How is your faith? Is your faith in Jesus? But what if, just what if, there's this underlying tone of trust? Do you trust? And many times those overlap, trust and faith, but this word trust. So as we read this, think of that. Verse 25, and shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. And when the disciples saw him walk on the lake, they were terrified. It's a ghost, they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid. But Lord, if it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. He asked for it. I mean, how many times have you been praying for something and you get it and you're like, God, why? And God's like, you asked for it. Yeah, but I wanted it that way. No, you asked for it. You weren't specific enough in your prayer. So he's like, okay, well, come then. Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water. Guys, he walked on the water. He walked on the water just like Jesus. And came toward Jesus, but when he saw the wind, the circumstance, the situation, he was afraid and began to sink. And it's easy to look at somebody like Peter and like, oh, dude, just keep your eyes on Jesus, man. Just keep your faith. Just, well, would you have got out of the boat? I mean, if Jesus told me to come, I would do it. Really? You don't even trust Jesus with your life. Much less, you don't trust Jesus sometimes in everyday life. I have trouble sometimes trusting Jesus with everything. And we can look at Peter as this bad guy who took his eyes off Jesus and he lost faith. But guess what? He's the one who got out of the boat. You ever been the armchair quarterback in a game? Why didn't that kid just throw that ball like that? I'm like, dude, you're sitting in your chair and you spilled beer on your t-shirt and you're completely out of shape and you're yelling at a 19-year-old who's given his whole life to play a sport. Like, chill out a little bit. I used to get worked up about football. I mean, I still love football, don't get me wrong. And then I realized one day, I am losing my ever-loving mind over an 18-year-old wearing tight pants throwing a ball. Get it together, Carlos. I'm mad at my wife, I'm mad at my children, I'm giving them the silent treatment because my favorite team lost, and my wife's like, is it worth it? It's okay to hit your husband right now, it's okay. Give you permission. And it's so easy to look at Peter and say, oh, dude, come on. Come on, keep your eyes on Jesus, man. Just keep, you can do it. But he got out. And yet when he begins to sink, he cries out, Lord, save me. Why am I stopping right there? Because even when he was sinking, what did he do? Did it say he swam and got back to the boat on his own? He trusted that Jesus could save him. Even in the water, in the storm, sinking in the water, he had a choice to make and he chose to trust. Trust is in our hands. The second thing about trust is what brings us strength. 17:5, what brings you strength? If you're gonna put your strength in humans, you know, you're setting yourself up for failure. You really are. What brings you strength? Where am I getting my strength? Is your strength coming from God? Psalm 121 says, I lift up my eyes to the hills or to the mountains. Where does my help come from? And my help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. That guy on the video just said, when he's running and he stops and he looks up. How many times do we stop and look up and say, God, I don't know what's going on, but I trust you. Do you find your strength in God? Do you find your strength in relationships? Maybe there are some godly relationships in your life that really encourage you and push you to be better. Maybe there's some people that God wants to surround you with. That's why for the last year or 15 months or longer here at Gateway, we're saying, don't do life alone. Find strength in relationships that God maybe wants to bring to you. 2 Samuel chapter 1, I love this verse, it's David. David was a king in Israel, but before he was king, he had a best friend, Jonathan, who was the prince. His dad was the king, and they were best friends, and they fought for one another, and they helped each other. You know, Jonathan's dad wanted to kill David. Can you imagine your parents wanting to kill your best friend? That's the situation. And Jonathan ends up dying, and David says this, I grieve for you, Jonathan, my brother. You are very dear to me, and your love for me was wonderful, more wonderful than that of women. Wow. He's telling his best friend, the love you give me is so healing and so needed. I find strength. I find hope. I'm connected to God because of my relationship with you. And it's not some weird dynamic between David and Jonathan. It's truth. It's the depths of what we all want. I know. Let me talk to the guys for a second. Guys, we think sometimes women are complicated. If we were honest, and I'm gonna tell you, I talk to hundreds of men every single year, we're more complicated than women. Oh, wow, we got some hand claps on that one. Let me tell you why we're more complicated, because we have the same emotions, the same ups and downs, the same desires, and yet we put a filter to mask it, which then complicates it. You know what I know every guy wants? Every guy wants a friend. Every guy wants a fishing buddy, a golf buddy, someone they can call, someone they can cry with. Why do you think when you're 18 to 22, for many of you, you gave everything to that fraternity? Just to be in the fraternity? No, because there's this desire in you for connection. And that's okay. That's a God-sized desire where he puts godly relationships in men who will make you better. When I got married, I was part of this. This is so stupid. I can't even, I'm saying it. I was part of this group. We were called the Four Horsemen. We were in college. And you do stupid things in college like that, and you give yourself names. And we did everything together. We went skiing together. We took trips together. We did everything together. And I was the first one to meet a girl. Well, we all met girls, but, you know, first one to, like, meet the girl. And my wife broke up the band. She was Yoko Ono. And I was totally okay with it. I was enamored. I was great. And my friends had a really hard time. We were going to get married in June. So we planned my bachelor party. We went to Vail every year to go skiing. And so we're going skiing. And so we're doing this big hurrah. And we invited a bunch of our friends. And my wife calls me one day and says, hey, just so you know, we have to move the wedding. I'm like, that's great. The sooner the better. I can't wait to marry you. You know, blah, blah, blah. She goes, yeah, we're going to get married on this week. It was the week of my bachelor party. And of course, the boys didn't understand. And we got into a little bit of an argument, and my wife gets on the phone. If you've never met my wife, she's the sweetest thing. But don't make her mad. You know those people that are like introverts and they have pent-up frustrations? And when they talk, you're like, yeah, you don't talk very much, do you? Because I can tell, because it's what's coming out of your mouth is very hurtful. She gets on the phone with my best friends, and she, for 5 minutes, lets them have it. What kind of friends are you? You're supposed to make them better. You're supposed to be men. We're 21. You're like, you're supposed to be men. You're supposed to blah, blah, blah. And I was like, yeah, we're a bunch of kids who wear the same underwear for 4 days and go on ski trips. Like, we're college kids. We're dumb. And she looked at me one day, and she says, you can't hang out with guys who aren't going to make you better. You're a married man now. I'm like, but mom, these are my friends, you know? You need friends who don't have armpit stains in their t-shirts. You need friends who know how to iron a shirt. And I'm like, I'm not ready to grow up yet. And then my friends and I had a conversation, and we talked about how superficial our friendship was. We masked our relationship with golf and playing tennis and going to ski and doing all the going to ball games and all that kind of stuff. But inside of us, what we wanted was friendship. Where do you find strength? In friendships, in relationships, because trust brings us strength. Got kind of heavy, I know. We'll lighten up here in a second. If trust is about us and where we place it, and if trust brings us strength, and at least number three, trust helps us grow confidence. Trust helps us grow confidence. That's what scripture tells us. I mean, verse seven says, but blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, whose confidence is in him. And God wants your confidence to grow. I know some of us are not confident right now for several reasons. Maybe it's financial, maybe it's your education, maybe it's this, maybe it's that. Should I take that job? Should I stay in Austin? Should I do this? Some of you aren't confident because you just moved to Austin and you don't know anybody. I have met three couples from Miami in the last 2 weeks. Welcome. We're so glad you're here, but we want you to grow in confidence. Why? Because when we grow in confidence, we grow in confidence in our decision-making. We grow in confidence because others are beginning to extend trust to us. We grow in confidence even when the circumstances are bleak. What did Jeremiah tell us? Let's go back to it. Jeremiah says this, they will be like a tree planted by the water that sends out its roots by the stream. And do not fear when the heat comes. Its leaves are always green. It has no worries in a year of drought and never failed to bear fruit. Let me give you some imagery here. You know that person in your neighborhood that no matter what happens, they always have a green lawn and you hate them for it? God wants you to have that green lawn in your soul where there's sustenance and relationships and trust and growing in confidence that no matter the circumstance, whether we have rain the rest of the summer, which I'm totally okay with here in Austin, or there's nothing but heat and it burns everything up, that something about the root system in that lawn is bringing life and it comes out in the green. That your confidence would grow no matter the circumstance. Let me ask you a couple questions. I'm going to say them in first person, right? Because I want you to ask yourself these questions. Where have I been burned? And I need to acknowledge it. Where have I been burned? What grudges am I currently holding? And why do I struggle with trust? Some of us struggle with trust in a generic sense. Some of us struggle with trust in particular ways. Because if we don't answer those questions, it erodes confidence. It takes it away. I've shared this story before, you know, about as a child, I was a victim of sexual abuse. And it happened on two occasions, and it just really wrecked my life. And so I really had trust with, and I kind of shared that story with my college buddies, I had trust with really building confidence with guys, just because I had two men who violated me as a kid. And I filled it with, I have a ton of friends and a ton of relationships, but they were all really superficial. And Libby, my wife, really helped me work through that. But really where I saw the breakthrough kind of a couple of years after that story with my college buddies is I had a guy come into my life. And his name was Chris Duran. And Chris Duran chased me as a friend. Almost like it was awkward. I'm like, you really want to be my friend really bad. This is weird. But he chased down our friendship. And it really impacted me. And about 6 months into him chasing, I kind of gave in. I started hanging out with him, started building a friendship. And we became best friends. I mean, we even did the elementary school girl thing. We got matching tattoos. And my wife made fun of me, of course. But she saw something healing take place in me. God brought somebody into my life that helped heal my heart. And he didn't care what happened to me. He wasn't weirded out that I had been molested by two guys when I was a kid. Like it didn't faze him because he didn't see that when he saw me. And I needed to know that somebody, when they saw me, they didn't see me as a victim. They didn't see me as less than. They just saw me for me. And for years, this guy just loved me. And it changed my life. To the point where I can grow in trust. And now I trust. I know that it's for me to choose who I give it to. I know that it can grow. It's a commodity. Trust is a commodity. Are we growing it? What do you do with your other commodities? What do you do with your money? What do you do with your home? You care for it. You want to grow it. You want to make sure that it's everything it's supposed to be. You protect it. And trust, the trust in your heart is a commodity that you have to protect. And God wants you to grow it. And this last week, my trust was challenged. My trust was challenged to a point in a way that it's never been challenged because I love our church. I love Gateway. And I was out on business for Gateway on Tuesday. Caught an airplane and I was gone. I was working with the missions partner for our church. And as soon as I landed, my wife called me that my brother passed away on Tuesday. And I mean, it was crazy. Just how it all, went down. And the unhealthy part of me came out, is what I noticed. This part of me that said, oh, well, how can you be with your sister and the family? You've got business to attend to. You've got this, all these unhealthy thoughts. And I told our executive team, I told the team here at the North Campus, and he was a huge step for me with trust because I'm type A. I do give trust, but it's controlled. It's this way. And yet, nobody called me this whole week. Kind of made me mad. They didn't need me. And it wasn't they didn't need me, is that they trusted me and I trust them. And I was able to be with my family. And I'll go back for the funeral this Tuesday. And I was writing this message and writing the message for my brother at the same time and trying to wrap my mind around all of it. And yet at the end of the day, I also had to say, God, trust you. You know, because I want to take care of my sister. And yet, to look at my sister and say, yeah, we're going to care for you. We're going to love you. I'm going to help you figure out all the finances. We're going to take care of my nephews and my niece. We're going to do this together. But then I had to look at her on Thursday and I had to say, but your confidence can't be in me. Holy. Or Libby, or our family, your confidence has to come from your relationship with God. and we prayed together. Man, something happened in that room that was amazing. And I had to trust, and I'm still having to trust, and I will continue to trust, because if this situation with my nieces and my nephew and my sister being a widow now, like, if this all relies on me, I'm gonna mess it up. But if I can just support what God wants to do in my sister and in my family, we're in good hands. Can you say the same thing? Come hell or high water, God, I'm gonna have a moment where I get on my knees. I just say, God, I'm gonna rest in my brokenness, and I'm just gonna trust you. That's what we want for you. It doesn't matter the circumstance or situation you're facing. It's like, can you have the proverbial moment where you hit your knees and you just say, I'm empty. I am not trusting. And yet, God, I trust you. When I have nothing else left. And if all you have is mistrust, it's the greatest gift you can give God is mistrust, because it's an act of trust. So here's what we're gonna do. We're gonna end today loving you as a church. Whether you're watching online or at a campus or you're in the room, we normally sing songs and we want you to sing with us. But here's what we want you to do now. We want you to sit in whatever you are going through and allow us to sing over you. And then we're gonna pray and we're gonna move on. But we love you and we're for you. God wants you to open your heart in this series to trust, as hard as it might be. So listen to these words of this song.
As I walk into the unknown, questions come and questions go. Was there a purpose for this pain? Did I cry these tears in vain? I don't want to live in fear. I want to trust that you are near, and trust your grace that can be seen. Triumph and tragedy. Night will never end.
just come before you this morning. Some of us in the room, we don't even know, didn't even realize that that is what we're looking for, God. We are looking for hope. And so many of us have been looking in so many different places, God, in our jobs, in the economy, in our families, in our relationships. And yet you say, Jesus, that you offer a hope that the world can't take away. And God, we know that to get to hope involves trust. And so I pray, God, for everyone listening to my voice right now, for myself, God, would you help us to trust just a little bit more than we did coming into this room or turning on the computer or the TV this morning. God, you say that you're good. You say that you love us and you want good for us. Would you help us to take steps to trust you and find the hope that you offer, Jesus? We pray all this in your name. Amen. Hey, if you're in the room, if you're online, this almost feels a little bit weird, but can we just send some love to our pastor, Carlos, and his family? Can you just give it up for them and Carlos sharing? Yeah. And see, to find that hope, hope by definition is something that exists out here. It's something that we do have to give up a little bit of that trust to walk towards hope. And we believe at Gateway that there is hope to be found in this man named Jesus who offers abundant life for us and with us. And we want to help you take those baby steps toward the hope, the freedom that you've been looking for a long time, that we've all been looking for a long time. And the best way to do that is to find a way to get connected with us here. You heard Carlos say, don't try and do this alone. Don't try and walk through what you're trying to walk through alone. Find a class, find a group. We have classes that are launching this month. If you go to gatewaychurch.com/connect, we have a new webpage. You're gonna find all of our available groups and classes. Find a way to take a next step toward the hope, toward the connection that other people, as we're linking arms, we've found as we chase after Jesus together. Now, some of you have chosen to take a next step by partnering with us financially. Thank you so much for your generosity, because at Gateway, we are a generous community. The impact that you're making is not only affecting those in our church, in our city, but it's making eternal ripples around the world. And if you don't believe me, check this out.
For every dollar that is given at Gateway, we are making a difference, life by life. Together, we help meet the needs of our city, from meals and financial support to community and friendship. Displaced people and refugees are cared for and provided guidance as they establish their new life in a new place. We help the most vulnerable people in our community by providing access to organic produce and groceries. Strategic partnerships with international organizations, we holistically meet the emotional, physical, educational, and spiritual needs of some of the resource-poor communities around the world. We bring life and freedom to children, teenagers, families, couples, singles, college students, and young adults through serving teams, networks, community groups, life groups, and recovery groups. Through our local campuses and our online campus, we create the space for people to belong, serve, grow, and heal. Through what we give together, lives are impacted, communities are transformed, and our world is changed.
That's what you're a part of, Gateway. So thank you for choosing to partner with us. If you do want to take that step to give with us, we actually have a brand new online giving platform. If you've been hanging out with us, you would have gotten an email about it. But you can also still go to gatewaychurch.com/give. You can sign up that way. That's the way my wife and I do it. You can also text the word give plus a dollar amount that you want to give to the number that you'll see on the screen. And let me be one of the first to say thank you. Just like you saw in the video, it's truly making an impact all over our city, all over the world. Now, if you need prayer this morning and you're online, you can click the button that says request prayer. If you're in the room, find someone on our team with a staff lanyard. I'd love to pray with you out in the courtyard. You can find me there after. We are celebrating our graduates here at North Campus. So if you're a graduate, go out in the courtyard. Our student pastor is there to meet you. He's got a gift for you. We're continuing in our series, Trust Me If You Can, next week. Our South Campus pastor, Eric Bryant, is going to be joining us. So until then, we hope you have an awesome rest of your Sunday. If you're online, we'll catch you next week. If you're in the room, we love you guys. We love you online, too. We hope you have an awesome rest of your Sunday, and I'll see you guys later.